Welcome back to the Algae Corner with me, Dr. West Bishop. We have a very interesting episode today. I think you're going to like it, and I think you're going to learn a lot. We're talking about taste and odor issues associated with algae. Now, many of you guys may have encountered these or experienced, you know, algal taste and odor issues and not even known it. So we're going to open your eyes today and open your nose to some of these nuisance types of taste and odor that may be associated with algae and algal blooms. So specifically what we're going to cover today is three main areas. First are taste and odor compounds. So what are they? How many different types of taste and odor compounds exist, and which algae produce them? Next, we're going to talk about where taste and odor compounds cause problems in water resources. And lastly, give you a little overview of what you can do about it. How do you identify these and how do you solve those taste and odor issues? So to start, when we discuss taste and odor compounds, for today we're specifically talking about compounds that organisms produce. And really we're going to focus in on algae and cyanobacteria, those blue-green algae, the compounds that they produce and that we can detect with our nose and our taste buds at very, very low levels. So those are the compounds we're going to talk about today. But it's important to note there's many other types of bacteria out there that can produce taste and odor compounds, and then there's some chemical-based taste and odor issues like with sulfur and iron and manganese and water resources. We're really not going to focus on those, just again, those ones that algae and cyanobacteria can produce. Now, it's important to note that many different types of algae produce taste and odor issues. It's not just the cyanobacteria, it's not just MIB and geosmin, which we'll talk about in a little bit, but almost every algal group can produce taste and odor compounds, from the greens to the chrysophytes and the cynurophytes. So if you're just looking for one algal group or just monitoring for cyanobacteria, it certainly doesn't mean you won't have taste and odor issues or that taste and odor compounds can't be produced. And also, you know, with all those algal groups, there's many different taste and odor compounds. Now, as I said, MIB or methyl isoborneol and geosmin, these are real sort of dirty and fishy smelling and tasting in water. Those are very common, and a lot of people monitor for those, but again, important to note, there's over 200 different types of taste and odor compounds associated with every algal group. So if you're just looking for those two, you may be missing a lot. And some of these can be even more potent and cause bigger issues in water resources than just those two ones you've probably heard about. So where do these algal taste and odor compounds cause issues? So there's three main areas we're going to cover today. First is drinking water sources, so those potable water reservoirs. You know, getting those taste and odor compounds in there makes that water smell bad, taste bad, sort of gets on your skin when you shower. Pretty nasty. So potable water is big. Next is the farm fish or aquaculture. So it can build up in fish or shrimp, causing them to taste really bad. Also a big area to focus on for algal taste and odor issues. And lastly is just that backyard smelly pond or the golf course pond that smells bad and no one wants to be around it. So those are three areas we're going to talk about, these taste and odor issues with algae. So to jump in, drinking water first. A lot of different algae can cause issues in drinking water. Here's just a quick list of some of those common types and the odor threshold concentrations that basically tell us what density of algae is growing out there that humans can detect and smell if you have that algae growing out there. So those are the critical cell densities that we can really look at and say, man, we got a problem with our nose and our taste. And you know, next up in this drinking water, I just want to go through a little list for you of some of those common types that we've encountered in these potable water systems, the specific groups, and give you a little description of how people have described those taste and odor compounds. So first are the chrysophytes. Now, these are one of the most potent ones I've encountered. Dinobryon is the species here, and it produces a very, very potent fishy odor in the water body. So even very low densities of this dinobryon, people described it as, oh, really, really fishy tasting in the water. So those chrysophytes, they like the cooler times of year. We actually treated some under the ice this year. They were blooming and causing taste and odor issues. So dinobryon chrysophytes is one group. The next group is the cynurophytes. So cynura and malamonas, again, very potent producers of taste and odor compounds. These have been described as cucumber or muskmelon or very bitter smelling and tasting in the water. Again, big nuisance organisms there. Another group is the diatoms. These can produce many different taste and odor compounds as well. They like mixed up reservoirs and grow in very cool times and can pose great taste and odor issues. These have been described as fishy and swampy. Cynedra is usually more earthy and musty, but very potent smelling. many have been described as geranium smelling too. So very interesting, the diatoms causing taste and odor issues. Even the green algae and desmids, most of the time these are described as grassy in the water body, but potent sort of grassy smell and taste from the green algae. Dinoflagellates, one of the big ones is ceratium and water resources, and that one's been described as sort of a bitter or a septic and fishy type of taste and smell. So many different groups produce them. The biggest one, not least here, is the cyanobacteria. So many different types of those cyanobacteria. They are a big group that produce these taste and odor compounds, but a couple of the descriptions I want to go through, I thought these were pretty cool how people described them. But dolichospermum or anabina, formerly known as, can be moldy, grassy, vile, pigpen, septic smelling and tasting in water. So, pretty nasty. Another one, microcystis, has been described as sweet, grassy, but vile and rotten and smoky and muddy all at the same time. So pretty nasty in and of itself. Yet some other ones, often described as moldy, grassy, you know, musty, earthy, fishy. They produce a lot of different compounds, but certainly the MIB and geosmin we talked about are common from this group of cyanobacteria. So that was just a quick overview of many different algal groups in drinking water and the description of those taste and odor compounds that that they can produce. Next category is aquaculture. Now, in aquaculture, the biggest issue of these algal taste and odor compounds is building up in the flesh of what you're trying to grow. So the shrimp, the salmon, and the catfish industry is very, very big. So if you have these algal blooms that produce taste and odor compounds in those industries, it can really, you know, negatively impact the quality of the produce, what they're trying to sell there, the overall product. So the fish fillet in particular. No one wants to eat a real sort of dirty, musty smelling and tasting seafood. And cyanobacteria, again, the biggest producers, biggest culprits in these aquaculture systems, mainly producing the MIB and geosmin, again, that can build up in that fish tissue and really cause it to be a nasty taste that no one wants to buy and no one wants to eat. And the last category we want to talk about is just around the pond. So that backyard pond, again, the HOA pond or that golf course pond, no one wants to be around it if it really smells bad and looks bad. And there's a handful of type of algae out there that can really cause that system to smell bad and look nasty. So some of them are even good types of algae like Spirogyra. When that sort of dies off, it looks bad and brown, but it's one of the worst smelling things you've ever smelled that can just be coming out of your pond. Lingbia out there, those big thick black mats, again, can produce, you know, those dirty and fishy smells and odors coming out of your pond. Caro, that macroalgae, can produce this muskgrass or garlicky or sulfur type of compound. Some people even describe it as a skunk coming out of the pond. Other types of cyanobacteria like nostoc, they can grow even in the wet areas of soil around the pond, but those smell, you know, pretty dirty and musty as well. So just, you know, from grassy to vile to sewage to pig pen, you can get those smells right out of that backyard pond as well. So those are, again, the three main areas that we wanted to cover today on where algae taste and odor issues are the biggest concern. So drinking water, aquaculture, and just, you know, just your recreational or aesthetics for your backyard pond. So what do you do about these taste and odor producing algae? How do you solve them? Well, our approach is a lot of monitoring, that routine monitoring, looking for them, and when you see them, that rapid response, getting in there, solving the problem, try to catch them early before they start causing issues, before they can really build up in the fish tissues or get to high levels in drinking water sources. So I just want to give you a quick example here on a drinking water reservoir. This is one we've been monitoring for a long time. We do this routine monitoring. We look for those taste and odor producing algae. It's mostly cyanobacteria in these reservoirs, and we control them, you know, at very low levels before they cause issues. We're using SeaClear algicide and water quality enhancer here, getting great results. You know, shut off that source, and even 2 days after treatment, we can see this great increase in clarity and removal of those sources of taste and odor issues in water bodies. We see this significant decrease down below human detection thresholds, even a day after treatment. So very effective approach here of that monitoring again, you know, looking for them, keeping an eye out for them, and rapidly implementing an effective solution as soon as we see them. Keep them under control, keep that drinking water looking and tasting good. So in summary today, what we talked about was taste and odor issues associated with algae. We covered, you know, those taste and odor compounds, you know, what are they, who produces them, and how people describe what they smell and taste like. Next, we covered those main areas where they cause issues. And lastly, we talked briefly about what you can do about it, how you solve those taste and odor algae issues. So thanks for tuning in to this very special episode on algal taste and odor compounds and the issues they cause. Now, if you're experiencing these, please get a hold of us. We can help you design that monitoring and implementation program to solve them, to stay ahead of it so you don't have those issues. Again, thanks for your time today, and thanks for tuning in to this episode of Algae Corner.